Turn in your Bibles, if you will, to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. We'd like to look into God's Word today and find out what God has to say about the subject of music. Now, God has much to say in the Bible about music. In fact, you'll find some people say that there are over 600 references to music in the Bible. Some people say 800, some people say 400, but at least there are very many references to music. Now, we call this seminar or kind of a sermon. It's kind of the cross between the two, kind of a sermonar. We call it God-approved music. God-approved music. What kind of music does God approve of? Is there a certain kind of music that He approves of? Is there a kind of music that He doesn't approve of? Does He say it in His Word? Well, we're going to look today to find out exactly what God says about music. And before I go on, I would like to say a couple of things here as kind of a way, in way of introduction. First of all, if you're here today and you haven't accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, what I'm about to say probably won't make much sense to you. The most important thing for you to do is to accept Jesus Christ as your own personal Savior, that you may have a home in heaven. Then these things will become evident to you as you grow in your Christian life. The most important thing for you to do is to accept Jesus Christ today. But then there are other Christians who come into this kind of a seminar, and they listen to what God's Word has to say, and yet they have in their minds, they say, well, as long as you don't talk about my favorite kind of music or my favorite kind of performer or my favorite performer himself, then I'll listen to you. But as soon as you mention their name, boy, that's it. I'm not going to listen to you anymore. Now, that's no attitude for a Christian to have. A Christian should say, whatever is in my life, if it's not good, if it doesn't belong there, then I'll get it out of my life. I'll get rid of it if the Lord says it's bad, if it's wrong. And so we should look into God's Word with an open heart today, no matter whether it's our favorite kind of music, our favorite kind of performer, that we might be able to say, Lord, just prove what is good in my life. Now, before I go on any further, I'd also like to cite a couple of authorities where I get this. You'll see down here on the table that I have very many books down here of different authorities on this subject. The two that I'll probably be quoting from the most, though, today is, first of all, Dr. Frank Garlock of the Symphony of Life Seminar. Now, he takes in about 3 days, two sessions a day, or maybe two days and three sessions a day, whichever, he takes to speak on the same subject. And you can see that he has six tapes here in the Symphony of Life Seminar. He has six different messages that they give on this subject. Now, Mr. Ron Hamilton has been traveling with Dr. Frank Garlock, and they have a brand new seminar that they have out now. But they talk about, both of them talk about this subject that I'm going to be talking about today. So you realize how quickly we're going to have to cover it in the next few minutes we have together. Also, you'll notice that we have some charts that we're going to be showing you here today. And I get those from a man named Lowell Hart, who wrote this book, Satan's Music Exposed. Now, this really did open my eyes to what Satan is doing today. And it's an excellent book that talks about the things that Satan is doing in music today. So Lowell Hart, Satan's Music Exposed. Now, we'd like to show you three different things today. First of all, we're going to look at God's Word. That's the most important thing. Man's opinion doesn't make any difference. In fact, a lot of people would say, well, Brother Chris, you have your opinion on music, and I have my opinion on music. And if you're from the city, you like city music. If you're from the country, you like country music. If you're an old person, you like old people's music. If you're a young person, you like young people's music. It's just a matter of taste, what kind of music you like. And yet, God definitely does have things to say about music. And we'd like to look in His Word today, first of all, from the Bible. Secondly, we're going to give you some facts from music history, just kind of a short course in music history. And then we're going to show you some examples, play for you some examples that you'll be able to tell exactly what I'm going to be talking about today. So first of all, here in God's Word, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 21 and 22. But before we go any further, let's open with a word of prayer. Our most gracious Heavenly Father, we do thank You for the time You've allowed us to have today. Lord, I do pray that You might open our minds and our hearts to Your Word today. Lord, I pray that You might just give utterance, Lord, and that You might have Your Word to be spoken in all its truth and clarity. Lord, I do pray that You might hide me behind the cross, that the Lord Jesus Christ might only be seen, that His truth might become evident to each one of us today. Show us the light, I pray, that our darkened hearts may be enlightened, Lord, I pray today, in Jesus Christ's precious name. Amen. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 21 and 22 will show us our first of three principles. We'd like to start out with three principles from God's Word, not necessarily in the realm of music, but we'd like to show you what God has to say about, in all areas of your life, these three principles that you can apply to any area of your life. First of all, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 21 and 22, which says, prove all things. Now, that's pretty simple. Prove all things. No matter what comes into your life as a Christian, you need to prove all things. Then it goes on and shows you two sides of this. It says, hold fast that which is good, abstain from all appearance of evil. On the one hand, he says, hold fast that which is good. If you find something in your life that you've proven and it's okay, well, then you can keep it. It's good. Hold fast to it. Don't let it go. But then on the other hand, it says, abstain from all appearance of evil. If it's not good, if you find that after you've proven it that it's not good for a Christian to have in his life, then get rid of it. Get as far away from it as you possibly can. In fact, it says, abstain from any appearance of that evil. Okay, so the two sides, hold fast to that which is good, abstain from all appearance of evil. You'll find this principle given for us elsewhere in God's Word. Turn, if you will, with me over to Ephesians chapter 5, verses 10 and 11. We find this elsewhere in God's Word, but here we find it, here in Ephesians chapter 5, verses 10 and 11, which says, proving, there's that word again, proving what is acceptable unto the Lord, and have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. Now we see the two sides here again. It says proving, we should prove all things that come into our lives. But secondly, prove what is acceptable unto the Lord. If it's okay in your life, then okay, keep it. But then you also see it says, have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. And that's what we'd like to do today. A lot of people would say, well, I don't listen to that kind of music, but I don't think you should be telling people what is really wrong with that, what's wrong with their kind of music. And yet God's Word says, don't even have any fellowship with it, but also reprove that thing. Okay, so we'd like to show you some of Satan's devices today, proving what is acceptable unto the Lord. Now, we find that we like to have things proven all the time in our lives. You go down to the grocery store, you like to have things USDA approved or USDA choice. You like to have things passed by the Food and Drug Administration. During the Tylenol scare some time ago, we found that people were saying, hey, what's wrong with this? You know, we have to have things tested. We have to make sure it's safe. You like to have the little UL written on the back of appliances that you buy. Underwriter Laboratories has tested this, and it's been approved. Now, take, for instance, if I wanted to go on an airplane ride today. I've never been up in an airplane before, and so this is the first time. And so here I go, and I go down to the airport, and I start to walk up the stairs to get on the airplane, and the stewardess, or the airline attendant, or whatever they call them today, comes up to me and said, Mr. Babcock? I said, oh, what do you know? Somebody knows my name. Yes, that's me. And she said, well, there's a couple of things I need to tell you before you get on this airplane. I said, oh, well, what's that? She said, first of all, this plane has never been up in the air before. plane is... Never been up in the air before. Well, okay, and there's something else? Oh, yes, there's something else. The pilot's never flown before either. pilot's never flown before, and plane's never been up in the air before. I'd say, I see you later, and I'd walk back down the stairs. I dare say any one of us would do the same thing. You wouldn't get in that airplane. You'd say, now you take that airplane out, and you test it, make sure it flies. I'm not sure how those things can fly anyway, but you make sure that thing flies, and then you go and take that pilot, and you make sure that he can he's passed all his... tests, and he's had all the airtime that he needs, and you make sure that he can fly that thing, and then maybe, now I'm not even sure, but maybe I might fly in that airplane. You want to have things proven. And yet, how many Christians do I see that just sit down and, you know, they turn on the TV set and they watch anything that comes on, never bother to seeing whether it's acceptable in God's sight? They just listen to the radio and any music that comes on, if it makes them feel good, if they just happen to like it, if it happens to suit their personal tastes, they say, well, it must be okay for me to listen to. And the next dress style that comes out, the next fad that comes out, Christians just go right out and buy it. They just go and never bother to see whether or not God approves of that thing. We need in our Christian lives to approve all things. Now, as I go on, I'll be talking about many kinds of music. And perhaps I might be talking about your kind of music. But God's Word says, prove all things, even if it happens to be your favorite kind of music. God's Word says, prove everything that comes into your life. If it's good, okay, hold on to it. But if it's not good, get away from it. Avoid all appearance of evil. Okay, so that's the first principle. Prove all things. The second principle is separate or be different in your life. It says in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 14 and following. If you turn there, 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 14 and following, it says this. Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion hath light with darkness? And what concord hath Christ with Belial? Or what part hath he that believeth with an infidel? And what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? Now those are good questions. What's the answer to every one of those questions? Well, is there any agreement between the temple of God and idols? No. Is there any fellowship, or what part hath he that believeth, with an infidel? None. Is there any fellowship or agreement between Satan and Christ? No, there's none at all there. And so God's word goes on to say there in verse 17, wherefore, or because of this, come out from among them, and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing. God means for his people to be different. He doesn't want his people to be like everyone else in the world. He means for there to be different. He means for there to be a difference in your life. And yet, as we go from place to place around the country, we find that there are many Christians that just don't make any difference there. They just dress the same way the world does. They look the same way the world does. They have the same kind of music, the same kind of pastimes, the same kind of pleasures, the same kind of language. Everything's the same as the world. And God says that this should not be. He said that Christians need to be different. Now, this just didn't happen in just recent times where Christians started acting and dressing and having all the things like the world. It even happened back in Israel's time. If you look in Ezekiel 22 and verse 26, you probably don't have time to turn there right now, but write that reference down. Ezekiel 22 and verse 26, which says this, her priests have violated my law and have profaned mine holy things. They have put no difference between the holy and profane, neither have they showed difference between the unclean and the clean. What were these priests doing? They were making no difference between that which was God's, that which was holy, and that which was of the world or Satan, that which was profane or unclean. And God's word says that if you don't make any difference there at all, it's a violation of his law. You can't mix something of the world and take it with the things of God and make it to reach more people for Jesus Christ. God's word says it's a violation of his law, a violation of God's law. So it says, they have put no difference between holy and profane, neither have they put difference between the unclean and the clean. Now, where do we find this happening today? Well, it's happening all the time with the dress styles and all the different things, but we're even finding that they're trying to use the music of the world to reach people with a spiritual message. And it doesn't work. God's word says it can't work. It says that it's a violation of God's law. You can't put the things of the world in with the things of God and expect the things of God to be any greater. In fact, all the way from the beginning of time, God meant for there to be a difference between his people and the people of this world. In fact, he made certain differences that I believe with my whole heart are meant to be kept even today. He said, right at the beginning of time, he said there will be a difference between light and darkness. He said further on, as you looked at through the Old Testament, that there will be a difference between his people and the rest of the people of the world. In fact, the children of Israel were commanded to drive out those people in front of them. They weren't even supposed to leave any of them there in the countries that they conquered. Why? Because they didn't want them to be intermarrying with them and taking their gods. And yet, the children of Israel didn't listen to that commandment of God. And so they started taking the idols and they started getting in all kinds of trouble because they didn't do what God had said. They weren't different than the other people. God meant for there to be a difference between the Levites, the priestly tribe, and the rest of them. Even their clothes and everything was supposed to be different. God meant for there to be a difference between the races. God meant for there to be a difference between man and woman. God meant for all of those differences. And in fact, if you look today, you'll find that Satan is trying very hard to break down those differences in people's lives. He's trying very hard to break down those differences that God has set up and meant for there to be a difference. And nowhere do we see this more prevalent than in the difference between the world and with a Christian. A Christian should look, dress, act, and even smell different than this world. God meant for there to be a difference. Okay, so that's the second principle, that whether it's your music or no matter what part of your life it is, God meant for there to be a difference in your life between that and the people of this world. But the third principle we find, if you'll look there in Ephesians chapter 5, you might have to flip back there. Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 6, we see the third principle outlined for us. The first one was what? It was that we prove all things. The second principle is that we'll be different, that we'll be separate than this world, from the things of this world. And the third principle is, don't be deceived. It says here in Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 6, let no man deceive you with vain words, for because of these things cometh the wrath of God upon the children of disobedience. Let no man deceive you with vain words. Now this word vain means empty. In other words, the words become empty of their meaning. You take the words, you empty it of its meaning, and then become vain. And people are deceived by these vain words. Now, people are being deceived with vain words all the time nowadays. In fact, you'll find that a lot of people say that they're saved or they're born again. and they really don't mean it. You say, what do you mean empty the meaning of its, you know, empty the word of its meaning? Well, take for instance, if I were to come up here and I say,
no, I want you to know today that that I'm really happy.
You say, Brother Chris, that's kind of hard to believe that you're really happy.
No, what? I said I was happy.
You say, well, you can't believe it. I can't believe that you're happy because you're just blubbering all over yourself and you're crying. You can't believe that a person's happy when they're doing that. Oh, but I said I was happy. You can't believe that? Or take, for instance, if I were to stand up here and say, now, Chris Babcock is a real man. I mean, he doesn't wear lace on his pants. He's a real man. He's going to come preach to you today. And I were to come up here and say, hi, everyone. Oh, it's so good to see you all. No, I'm so glad. Oh, why are you laughing at me? Don't laugh at me.
You say, Brother Chris, I would really start wondering about you. You say you're a real man, but you don't act like him.
I said, well, I said I was a real man. Come on, guys.
He said, well, I can't believe you. Why? Because the actions really speak louder than the words, and the words become emptied of their meaning. The words become emptied of their meaning. Now, I found this as I was down at Bob Jones University. We found that as you went knocking door to door, about everyone down south is saved. Or they say that they're born again. You don't go to somebody's door and say, are you saved? Because they say, oh, yes, I'm saved. Well, then you might ask them a few more questions. You say, well, if you were to die tonight, are you sure that you'd be in heaven? And they say, well, I don't know that, but I know I'm saved. Well, what has happened? They've taken the word and emptied it of its meaning. There are many performers, in fact, that of rock and roll music that have taken the word born again or saved, and they've just twisted it around, and you can't believe it anymore. They become vain. Take, for instance, there was one performer that said, he was born again. Well, somebody happened to ask him. A famous magazine asked him. They said, well, how do you know that you're born again? He said, well, it's simple. I was out walking under the stars one night looking up at God's great creation, and I looked up at the moon, and I thought I saw the face of God, and I had a deep peace in my heart, and I knew that I was born again. Well, is that salvation? Well, not in the least. Not in the least. And yet, oh, he said the right word. He said born again. And yet, because of the context, you know that he can't really mean that he's born again. It's not what God's word says. The words have become vain. Take, for instance, like we're talking about music today. If you take the music of the world and mix it with the things of God, does it make the things of God come any further? Does it make them any better? No. In fact, it becomes profane. It becomes empty and vain as we find it in God's word. Take, for instance, and people say, well, you know, rock music is just amoral. In fact, any music is amoral. You can't say that music has morals one way or the other. And yet, certainly, we can see that any other form of communication can be used that way. As the last time I talked to Dr. Frank Garlock, he gave me these thoughts. Take, for instance, can a man with his lips use syllables and pronounce things in such a way as to become profane and to say obscenities? Well, of course he can. We use that in speech. People can do that. Take, for instance, can a person use a pen and maybe a pencil and use colors or some kind of art, and with that just draw some lines and draw a pornographic picture? Well, of course he can. And yet a lot of people say, well, music is all moral. You can't have morals one way or the other in music. And yet you can, by using just simple notes and measures, you can produce pornographic music. Music that is profane in God's eyes. It just goes to prove. Take, for instance, even the people of the world know this. There was a man named Alan Bloom, the professor at the college of the University of Chicago. He says this about rock music. It is a music that moves the young powerfully and immediately. Its beat goes to the depth of their souls and inarticulately expresses their inarticulate longings. Those longings are sexual, and the beat appeals most exclusively to that. The words make little difference. Did you catch that? He says the words make little difference. The motor of it all is eroticism. The youngsters know this perfectly well, even if their parents do not. And what I'm sorry to say is that the people of the world know this perfectly well, even if Christians do not. And here there are many people, even Word Record Company and many of the other ones, state that, well, music is amoral. There are no morals to music, and yet even the people of the world know better than that. They say the music itself is sexual and against God. You know, take for instance, take if you were going to, we're going to give you a couple of examples here, kind of whet your appetite today. We're going to kind of whet your appetite by giving you a couple of examples from the music of this world. Take, for instance, the word redeemed. Now, the word redeemed, we look in the Old Testament, we hear about the kinsman redeemer. In the New Testament, how we are redeemed with the precious blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's a marvelous word, a word that holds much for those who are redeemed, those who are saved by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. And yet, what happens when you take that word and put it in a wrong context, or if you put it to this kind of music? Hold on to your seat.
I feel good. I feel good. Just to know I feel good.
Well, in case you couldn't understand that, what they were saying is, I feel good, just to know I've been redeemed makes me feel good. Well, that's good theology, isn't it? And yet, oh, they said the word redeemed, oh, we can take that word, oh, isn't it marvelous how they're getting that word out to so many people? And yet you see that the music is saying something entirely different, something that's entirely against the word. It's just like me coming up here and say, oh, I'm really happy. You can't believe me. And so you can't believe, even if the message is proposed to be good, you can't believe it because of the music in the background. Or take, for instance, the words, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, a great hymn. The words are almost right from Scripture. And as you take words like that, that I believe even the angels are singing around the throne of heaven today, and you put it to this kind of background, what happens? I have to excuse my examples. I get these secondhand, so if they skip, you'll understand the problem.
Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, earth our soul
like
shall rise to thee. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty, God in three persons, blessed Trinity.
Now that was supposed to be a Christian song. And you say, well, I couldn't see much wrong with that. I mean, the first one, yes, I could see that, but not the second one. Well, I hope by the time that we're done today that you'll be able to see exactly what I'm talking about. What I'm talking about, how you can deceive many people with vain words. When the music is saying one thing and the world says that that kind of music is sexual, is against God, is feeding the old man, the old nature, then how can you reach somebody with a spiritual message? You can't. What does God call that? He says it's a violation of His law. When you mix the profane things of the world with the things of God, it becomes a violation of God's law, and all you do is deceive people with your empty, vain words. So what are those principles again? First of all, prove all things. If it's good, okay, keep it. Hold on to it. Hold fast to it. If it's not, abstain from any appearance of that evil and don't have any fellowship with that thing. Second principle is to be different. Come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord. We need to have our music to be different, and don't violate God's law by mixing the things of the world in with the things of God. But then the third principle is that we don't be deceived with the vain things of this world. Don't be deceived, even if the words are okay, still the music may be saying something entirely different that may empty the words of its meaning, and you'll be deceived. Now we'd like to look at some charts that we have from music history. And okay, there we have the charts from music history. We see on the one side over here, over on the left-hand side, we have music of the world, and there's a word under that. And over on the other side, there's another word underneath. It says music of the church. Music of the world and music of the church. On the one hand, music of the world. Now, what's that word under there? It says sensual. Sensual. What's the first part of that word? Sense. In other words, it appeals to the senses first of all. Music of the world will appeal to the senses, first of all. A verse for that, 1 John chapter 2, verses 15 through 17, which says, all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. Talking about the lust of the flesh. In other words, this kind of music will appeal to the flesh, first of all. It'll appeal and feed the flesh, first of all. Now, under that, we see a couple of things here. If you look back in any culture, you'll find one of the first things they come up with is the primitive drums. So that's the first thing on the list. Primitive drums. Now some people say, well, no, it was the string instruments. But if you look back in just about any culture, whether it's the African, the Aborigines in Australia, or even in this country, in about any culture, you'll find that one of the first things they come up with is the primitive drum. Now, the primitive drum is used how? How do they use it? Well, they use it for their war parties, you know, before they go out and they're going to go scalp the other tribes. So what do? They build themselves up into such a frenzy. It builds themselves up physically, in other words. It's kind of a physical reaction they have to the drums. Or else, it's used for their fertility dances, where afterwards they'll have the wild orgies. It's a physical reaction they have to the primitive drums. Now, it came to this country in many ways. As I said, it was in this country to begin with, you know, with the Indians and the other cultures. But in all the cultures, it finally came to this country. We have the thing down here is slavery. And in slavery times, there's something else I wanted to mention under this anyway, that the slaves, when they were out in the fields, were very oppressed, and they kind of put a wailing to their music. They kind of put a kind of a wailing sound in their music, and this made them feel better. They could sing about their troubles, and much of the music around that time, you'll find that that's exactly what they were doing. They were kind of wailing and singing about their troubles. But to go on from there, a music that we have even today came out of that kind of music, and it's called blues. Blues. Now, you know that when people are singing the blues or he's feeling blue, it's talking about somebody who doesn't feel very well and they're feeling bad about their situation, and so they sing about it. And that's exactly what the blues is. It's talking about, I'm feeling so bad. I'm feeling so terrible. Now, Neil Diamond wrote a song about Song Sung Blue, I think it was titled. And he talked about how, well, once you sing the song, you sing it over and over again, sing about your troubles, and then after a while, you'll start feeling better again. Now, feeling better how? Feeling better spiritually? No. Emotionally and physically. It's a kind of physical reaction to your troubles. Now, there's a kind of music that we have that doesn't come down the rest of this list, but comes directly from blues music. And we find it around today. It's called country western music. Yes, country western music comes directly from the blues. Now, if you listen to much of the words of country western music, of course, the words now are just as bad as rock music. A lot of people say, oh, well, I listen to country western. It's not as bad as rock. Oh, yes, it is. In fact, the beat is the same that they put in just a few years ago, put the same rock beat in the background, and the words are just as filthy. But if you listen to the words of country western music, what are they talking about? Oh, it's so terrible, I woke up this morning and you were gone, and you left me for somebody else, and then they left you for somebody else, and here I am on my way to Phoenix or on my way to Nashville, sitting in my semi-truck, thinking about you and all the times, good times we had, and now they're gone, and my wife ran away with my friend Jim. I don't miss her, but I do miss him. Or, you know, I'm kidding right now, but just about anything. It's talking about how that, I'm so, you know, my life is so terrible without you. But now, what should God's people's reaction be to when troubles come in a person's life? Should it be, oh, this is a terrible life I'm living. I just can't, God, why are you doing this to me? Should that be a Christian's reaction? No, never. What should a Christian's reaction be? No matter what trouble come in a Christian's life, he should be able to say, praise God, from whom all blessings flow. So should a Christian ever be singing the blues? Never, not with all that we have in Christ Jesus. Christians should never be singing the blues. So then should a Christian ever be singing country western music or having that kind of music in their life? No, because all it is an updated version. And anymore, you'll find that the words are just as filthy as that in rock music, and some people say that it's even worse because you can understand what country western music is saying. Sometimes you can't understand the words in rock music. But we don't want to get stuck there. We want to go on, and you find it down the list. We have primitive drums, slavery, blues, country western, the same line. Then under that, we have ragtime, where they started putting a little syncopation, a little of the beat in there. And then we have jazz music under that. And this is where they put the drums or the beat of the primitive times, and they have kind of the wailing with the slavery times and kind of a little bit of the blues in there, and they put it all together and they have jazz music. And then down from there we have swing, and a little bit further in music history we have boogie woogie and then bop, and I didn't name those, that's what they call them. Anyway, goes on, and we have rock and roll music then. And even the term rock and roll was coined by a disc jockey to say what two people did in the back seat of a car. Well, that's real good. They say, oh, this music, we can use rock music to bring people to Jesus Christ. When even the world realizes that the music itself, not the words now, the music itself is something that's sexual and feeds the old nature. What was the word up there? Music of the world? Sensual. Feeds the senses, first of all. Appeals to the senses, or the old nature, the old body, first of all. Well, of course, it's gone on from there to disco and new wave music and punk this and punk everything, you know, anymore. But if you'll find that all of those things deal with the senses. It appeals to the senses or the body of a person, first of all. Now, on the other side of the chart, we have, on the right side, we have music of the church, or music that should be in the church or in a person's life who's a Christian. And there's a word under that that says spiritual. Now, what's the first part of that word? Well, spirit. In other words, this kind of music should appeal to the spirit, first of all. Okay, and a verse for that, we might take down Colossians chapter 3 and verse 16, which says, "Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord." Spiritual songs we should have in our heart. We should have psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, songs that appeal to the Spirit, first of all. Now, as we look down this list, we have, first of all on the list, psalms. And yes, that those psalms that you have in your Bible, that was the songbook of Israel. They were the songs that the children of Israel sang. And we don't have the music to that, but they were praising God with the words. And we do even know that David, who had much to do about the psalms, many of the psalms were written by him. It says, even as he was playing for King Saul, that the spirit that was in Saul left him. And we find that he was physically refreshed. He was refreshed, and the spirit left him. And so we find that even the music, now he played with his hand, it says. It doesn't say that he was actually singing, but he played cunningly with his hand. And so the music that he played was spiritual music. All right? Spiritual music. But then we go on, the early hymns, even in fact in Jesus Christ's time, before they left the upper room, they had sung a hymn before they went out. And we know that the Lord Jesus Christ would not have used music that was sensual in nature. But to go on, we have down, the next word we have there is Reformation times. Now, in Reformation times, not only did Martin Luther have a lot to do with reforming the doctrine of the time, which the church, the Roman Catholic Church of the time, was always talking about how it's works that gets you to heaven. And yet, Martin Luther, as he was reading God's word, found that it was by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. But also during that time, they also reformed the music of the time. Martin Luther had a lot to do with that, in fact, at the time. That the church had taken away from the common people the right to be able to sing the music, and only a few certain people could stand up in front and be able to sing the music. But Martin Luther had gave it back to the people so they could sing the music, and so it would be a spiritual refreshment to them also, which I believe is what God meant in the first place. But to go on from there, we have the chorales around J.S. Bach's time. Down from there, we have the great anthems of the faith, and then the hymn writers. Down like the Wesley brothers or Isaac Watts or many of them wrote great hymns where the music said exactly what the words were saying, and it was spiritual all in nature. Then we have the last thing on the list is spiritual songs, and good spiritual songs are even being written today. Now, they're hard to find, but they are still being written today. You have to look hard to find them, but you can find spiritual songs being written today. Now, down here, neither of the lists, we have, not on music of the world or music of the church, we have down at the bottom contemporary Christian music. Now, contemporary Christian, in fact, this is a misnomer, they say that it's contemporary. Oh, it's just happening now. This is brand new music, and yet the kind of music we're talking about that's against God's word is not really new at all. If you look back and try to find its roots, not talking about the words now, but talking about the music itself, you'll find that contemporary Christian music comes from blues music, you'll find country western, you'll find jazz, you'll find rock and roll, you'll find disco, you'll even find new wave or punk Christian music. Now, where are they getting the music? The music they're getting from a place that is sensual. They're finding the music in the sensual things of the world. And they say, well, it's immoral. And yet the music people of the world know that the music is saying exactly what the words are, that old sinful stuff of the world. People say, well, I realize it's wrong for me to listen to rock music because the words are bad. And yet we don't realize that the music is saying exactly what the words are. And if the words are bad, chances are the music is bad too. But we see here, music we're trying to talk about, contemporary Christian music, which we'd have to say, well, is it really Christian or not? We'd have to say that they're taking the music of the world and trying to reach people with a spiritual message, and you can't do it. What does God call that? He says it's a violation of his law. Violation of God's law. What are those principles again? Well, first of all, prove all things. Secondly, be different in your music. Don't violate God's law, and don't be deceived. Even if the words are good, still you can be deceived with the music being the wrong way. But people are always asking me, they say, well, Brother Chris, there's so many crossovers anymore. I mean, they're crossing over between gospel music and blues music and rhythm and blues and disco, and all of these are crossed over anymore. They have little pieces out of each one. How can you tell if the music that you use is worldly or not? Well, we find on this other chart, we'll find characteristics of worldly music. We'll find over here characteristics of worldly music. And under that, we have melody, harmony, rhythm, instruments, and electronics. Now, we'd like to go into each one of these in a little bit of detail here. In the melody, first of all, you'll find that they'll use an airy, limp tone. Now, before I go on, I would like to say where I got this list. It's from a man named Charles Henderson, who wrote the book How to Sing for Money. This is also documented in Lowell Hart's book. But you'll find that it's How to Sing for Money. Now, in other words, if you want to make money, and this person does not claim to be a Christian, he said, if you want to make money with your music, this is what you have to use. And this book was written in 1939. A lot of people say, now, wait a second, this is outdated. And yet these are the techniques that have been used by two generations of popular singers. Two generations, this is what they've been using. And so what does the world say itself? Well, if you want to sell music, if you want to make it popular, first of all, in the melody, you need a kind of an airy, kind of a limp tone. Now, all the time I've been talking to you today, I've been speaking in my full voice. And you'll find that they rarely use their full voice. Most of the time, these singers will kind of come down and kind of like this into the microphone. And that has a lot to do with electronics. We'll see after a while. But also, they use scooping and sliding. You say, Brother Chris, what are you talking about? Well, you find that they kind of scoop under the note, or they kind of slide down to it or slide up to it. In fact, the book stated that if you want to be popular with your music, you can't make your music too good. You say, wait a second. That doesn't sound right. You can't make your music too good? No, people can't stand exactness. And I believe that this is the reason that so many people don't like classical music. Because classical music is an exact kind of music. The rhythms are exact. The notes are hit exactly. All of those things are exactly. And it unnerves people to listen to that kind of music very long. They like to have music a little sloppy, and that's what the book stated. But it says, kind of, you scoop under the note, and how about if I talk to you that way? Or kind of talk to you sliding down all the time, or scooping under every one of my notes. You'd have a hard time listening to it. And yet, you find that you listen to music like that all the time. We'll show you some examples about that later. But then in the harmony, that's the next thing, you'll find many unresolved dissonances. Many unresolved dissonances. Now people say, wait a second, Brother Chris, what are you talking about? Unresolved dissonances? I don't even know what a resolved dissonance is, much less an unresolved dissonance. Well, we'll make it very simple so even you can understand. I couldn't find any better words to put it in. So we'll show you, even here, I have my fine pianist over here at the piano, and he'll play just these five notes for me. Now, I realize you're not excited about that. I mean, you know, that doesn't thrill you too much. But if you were to play just those five notes, you'd say, well, so what? Well, you see, the note that he ended on out of those five notes is a fairly consonant note. It's not really consonant, but it's a fairly consonant note. In other words, it doesn't really want to go anywhere else. You can feel satisfied if he just plays those five notes. But what if he plays these notes? You see, if he were to keep playing those notes, what would happen? Well, you have the physical reaction. You'd want to finish that note because the note he ended on was a very dissonant note. And he wanted to go on to that last note that you finally heard. And you just physically want to do that. In fact, if you kept playing those, some of you would probably get up out of your seat and play it here on the piano, or else stand up and go, la, or something, you know. You'd want to finish the note. You'd want to finish it. And that's what this dissonance does. Now, you like to have dissonance in music, but you like to always have it resolved. Always have it resolved, and then it feels like it's finished. And you'll find that a lot of these people, though, don't resolve the dissonance in their music. And so it becomes very tense, it becomes a very physical thing, and you always feel like it's not quite finished yet. I often wondered why many of these performers don't ever finish the song. You ever notice how it kind of trails off at the end, kind of slowly fades off into the distance? Well, it's because they don't want you to finish the song. They want you to listen to the next song and buy the next record they put out. And it works. It's exactly what they're using. So many unresolved dissonances. Then in the rhythm, that's the next thing, melody, harmony, rhythm, you'll find the very simplest terms, a heavy beat, even if it's on the right beat. And then the second thing is heavy syncopation. Now, a lot of people say, Brother Chris, I just got over dissonance, and now you throw another word at me. What in the world is syncopation? Well, take for instance, if we were to sing a song like, take for instance like this. There's within my heart a melody, Jesus whispers sweet and low. I'm giving you four beats up here. As I swing my arms, I'm giving you the one, two, three, four, one, two, three, four, One, two, three, four. One, two, three. Like that. And I'm not just waving my arms up here because it's hot up here, although sometimes it is. No, what I'm trying to show you is the most important beat is the first beat of the four. One, two, three, four. One, two, three. That's the downbeat. Now, if you take the most important beat, the downbeat, and put it anywhere else, it becomes syncopation. Now, what a lot of people do, in fact, what they say is the most important beat for them to use, and ask those who are in rock music, that they don't know why. I wish I could tell you the reason, but they say they don't even know the reason themselves. They say the most sensual beat they can accent is the third beat. And they make it more like this. Instead of one, two, three, four, it would be one, two, three, four, one, two, three, four. An accented third beat. And I'll show you what I mean by this just a little bit later. So we find the melody, the harmony, and the rhythm. Now you'll find that the melody most oftenly appeals to the spirit of a person. The harmony will appeal to the mind or the mental capacities. And then the rhythm will appeal to the body. These three things, and they need to be kept in that order. The next thing we find is the instruments. The instruments they use are, again, mostly rhythm instruments. You'll find that they use the drums, the bass, guitar, and the piano. You realize that here, right there in your church, you have a rhythm instrument. Yes, that is a rhythm instrument, because the piano is in the percussion section, the rhythm section of an orchestra. Now, take for instance, if you wanted to have a 100-piece orchestra, let's make it an orchestra, 100-piece orchestra. How many people out of 100 do you think would be playing rhythm instruments? How many? 10? 7? Chances are less than 5. Less than 5 people will be playing rhythm instruments. Out of 100? Yes, that's true. Now take one of these modern combos, like any of the ones that you see up here with the record jackets up here in front. You'll find that, what do they use? Well, maybe they use somebody for melody, okay, and 2 people for harmony. We'll make it a trio. That's a popular way of doing things. Make it a trio. 1 melody, 2 harmony. Then what do you have on the instruments? You have somebody on bass, somebody on guitar, lead guitar, somebody on the drums, and somebody on the keyboards. Well, what do you have there? You have 3 on one side, only 1 singing the melody, and 4 people playing rhythm instruments. You see, it's not balanced at all. And the rhythm has to be kept under control. Now, you need those 3 elements, melody, harmony, and the rhythm, in your music. And yet, the melody should be the most predominant. The harmony should complement the melody. And then the rhythm should be kept way down, way under control. I hope I have a pulse here somewhere. I hope that it's here. I can never find it when I want to. But I hope I have this pulse here somewhere, and it's got some rhythm. I need it to keep alive. But if the pastor down there where he's sitting were be able to look up here and see my pulse way down there where he's sitting and see it go ba-boom, 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 you'd say, boy, get that guy to a hospital. And I trust that you would. I hope that you would get me to a hospital. Why? Because he said, that guy is sick. And so the rhythm that's out of control is also sick music. Shows that it's sick music. So we go on from there, the melody, the harmony, and the rhythm, the instruments, then the electronics. You'll find an almost total dependence on a sound system. Almost a total dependence on a sound system. Now, people say, oh, Brother Chris, now look, you're using a sound system, and yes, we do. We use it for sound reinforcement. And yet some of these people can never be without one. Why? It's because they don't use their full voice like I have been all this time. They kind of use just kind of half their voice. And they don't really use their full voice. Now, if I were to come down here and whisper in any of your ears, you know, take this little fuzz button, or I guess it's a windscreen off. Most of the people don't use those. They like to make it sound like, hi, how are you today? And what it does is it takes away the zones that you have around you. You have 3 different zones that you keep around you. You have kind of a social zone that's about 3 feet from you or around there, about an arm's length, that you don't let too many people get within that zone unless you know them. Then you have a personal zone that's only, very close to you, like shoulder to shoulder, maybe a foot or so. But then you have an intimate zone that's very close to you. And you don't let hardly anybody get within that intimate zone. And yet when somebody uses electronics, either in the way of recording or in live performances, and they use it like talking that close, what they're doing is they're violating your personal zone. I mean, your intimate zone. Violating it. It's just like I would be whispering in your ear. Now, no matter whether you're singing good gospel words or not, if you're to come up and even if I meant the best, I say, hi, how are you today? Boy, some of you, if I came up there and whispered that in your ear, you'd probably run the other way. Well, of course you would. Why? Because it's violating your intimate zone. Now, this is what you'd want. You would not want to have it in your own life. You'd get upset if somebody got that close to you. And so, why would you have music that does the same thing? You see, it becomes very sensual, no matter whether the words are Christian or not. It becomes very sensual in its nature. Now, these are the characteristics of worldly music as we see them in the melody, the harmony, the rhythm, the instruments, and the electronics. And you'll find that the more of these elements that you have, the more sensual your music will become. And as you listen to this music, it feeds the old nature. Now, as a Christian, you don't want the old nature to be fed and to be strong because it will rule your life. But if you feed the spiritual nature of your life and starve the old nature, then you will become a spiritual Christian. So a Christian has no business having the kind of music that has these elements in it. The more elements, again, that you have, the more sensual your music becomes. Now, this didn't just happen overnight, that someone just woke up in the Christian realm and said, you know, I think I'm going to start putting sensual elements in my music so more people will listen to the gospel. No, it came by very gradually. In fact, now we'd like to show you some examples of music, some examples that will show you exactly what these characteristics are. Take, for instance, a man like Bill Pierce. Now, Bill Pierce was a brilliant arranger. He sang with the Melody Four Quartet for a while. He was also a soloist, plays the trombone. He had a program called Night Watch for a long time. Now it's called Night Sounds. Maybe many of you have heard him. But Bill Pierce, long years ago, used to have very good music. Here's an example. On the trombone. Now, what's on the top? What's the most obvious? Well, the melody. You hear the harmony, you hear the rhythm in the background. And what's the song that he's playing? Day by day, and with each passing moment, strength I find to meet my trials here. Beautiful arrangement, beautiful song. A song that says much in the way of Scripture. And you'll find this is also the case, that in many of these people that say that they're going to bring across a spiritual, scriptural message in their music by using this other music, they're really not using the scriptural message at all. It gets very watered down. But that was a long time ago. That was even before there was stereo. And a lot of kids say, well, there was a world before stereo? Well, yes, there was. And so that was Bill Pierce a long time ago. Here's Bill Pierce a few years later. Notice a lot more rhythm. Now, how about the way he's playing? Hear the scooping and sliding? Boy, it's hard to hit a note right yet. And what was the song? Reach Out to Jesus? You'll find that that song says a lot less in it than even Day by Day did to show you which way that they're going. But unfortunately, he didn't stay there. You noticed a little bit more rhythm in that. But this was taken from a record called This Is Bill Pierce. Just a second. Bill Pierce will be in a minute. As you listen to his playing, you'll find that it's taken directly from jazz techniques. He's trying to copy the jazz trombonist exactly. Now, I hope you were able to see some of those things on that list. And yet a lot of people say, well, listen, Brother Chris, that's not quite as bad as rock. That was just jazz. And you know, there are even those who are supposedly preaching the gospel that say that. There was an evangelist, calls himself an evangelist, that uses jazz techniques, even though he speaks out against hard rock Christian music. He said that it's of the devil. It's terrible. The young people shouldn't have it. And yet he has what's right next door. He has jazz techniques that he uses in his music all the time. That evangelist is Jimmy Swaggart. Yes, Jimmy Swaggart himself uses jazz techniques. If you listen to his piano, it's jazz piano. He tries to use, even in the sound of his voice and some of the things that he does, it's jazz. And even though it's right next door, it's still poison. A Christian has no business listening to it. It'll build up or feed the old nature. But perhaps you don't know Bill Pierce, and you say, well, I just don't understand that. Well, let's go to perhaps this group
who you might know.
Something beautiful. Something.
How many of you know this group? It's the Bill Gaither Trio. Now, Bill Gaither, when he started writing music many years ago, he was writing good music. It was good music. It was good scriptural music. But he didn't stay very long in that position. He started writing music for, just whatever would be popular at the time. And take, for instance, this was taken from back during the energy crunch. Remember when we had a hard time getting gas and there were all the long lines? This was taken back that far, but this will even show you what direction he was going in then.
Well, we thought at least if we're going to sing it, we ought to update it and write an extra verse.
Update it. I wanted to get that word there.
We just wrote an energy, special energy crisis verse that we want to sing for you. Gary, I'll sing the first part, and if I starts dragging, you jump in and help bail me out on it. And we want to dedicate this verse to all of our wonderful friends at OPEC. I've noticed all the bad news in the paper.
All the bad news.
This year gas is even higher still.
See a few of those elements there? And now, even since he's gotten the new Gaither vocal band and all the other things, he uses any technique he wants to. He uses disco techniques. He uses all the different kinds. You see, the music that you say, well, listen, I mean, I like that performer. They were my favorite. And yet, the music, as you hear it yourself, you say, I have to prove all things. Remember what the things were? Prove all things. The other principles? Be different in your music. There wasn't anything different between that music and the music of the world. And then don't be deceived. Even if the words sound good, still don't be deceived with vain words. Now, we heard a little bit of rock there, and there was some jazz before that. How about some ghetto blues music? Yes, this is supposed to be a Christian song. You'll find, if I were able to play the rest of that for you, you'd find that he's trying to sound exactly like a ghetto blues singer. He starts to go with the saxophone and the other instruments in the back, starts going, tries to make him sound exactly like those performers. Now, you can see this performer just about any Sunday morning or every other Sunday morning on a famous preacher's broadcast where he puts his arm around him and says, also on the broadcast today we'll have Robbie Heiner. That's who it was. That was Robbie Heiner. And even though when he's on the old-time gospel hour, he has all his music sound just fine. People say, well, I don't see anything wrong with it there, but in his records, what's he doing? He's going the way of the world. And you say, well, that's not very fair to say. And yet he said himself, quote, I see nothing wrong with the contemporary sound. You see, you say, well, I just didn't understand. I didn't know that. And yet God's word says, prove all things. Prove all things. Well, that was ghetto blues music. I want to show you just how far this has come and play you a little what they call Christian, quote-unquote, disco. Now, I want you to listen to the words because this will show you how people are being deceived with obviously vain words. You're going to have to hold on to your seats for this one. In case you couldn't understand, what a difference you've made in my life. You have to listen to that kind of music for that background, and you say, what? A difference? Is there a difference there? If there's a difference, I don't notice any difference, because that music sounds exactly like the kind of gay music that's being played all over. In fact, disco music was said that to relate to those people who were gays coming out of the closet. Disco music, that's exactly what it was. Or take, for instance, this one. This one really gets me. Listen to the words. You don't understand them.
Do you love the things that keep you bound in sin?
Did you you understand that? Do you love the things that keep you bound in sin? Well, you listen to that background and you say, well, obviously you do. You must love the things that keep you bound in sin. That sounds exactly like it. It sounds exactly like the world's music. And does that, as we look at the principles that we saw from God's Word, does that match up? When you see that, you say, well, is it? Have you proving all things? Is it good? Can you see that there's a difference between that and the world? No, you can't. And even though they're trying to tell you, here they're trying to tell you to get away from the things of the world to keep you bound in sin, they're still using those old things of the world. Now, it doesn't make any difference whether you attach Christ's words or even classical music to the old disco beat. It doesn't make it any better. And this Hooked on Classics is doing exactly that. And I know in a lot of Christian homes, I see that around a lot, that they're using that. You say, well, it must be okay. And yet it's just still the same old worldly sensual beat in the background. But to show you even one step further, and we didn't get this until just a little while ago, exactly what, well, take for instance, punk Christian music. You say, boy, you can't believe that, can you? Yeah, that was a Feral and Feral concert. A lot of people hear those things and they say, oh, that's terrible. That's terrible what it's doing. But you see, those things are all made up of those elements, those characteristics of worldly music. Now, the more you have, the more poison it is. But even if you have just a little poison, it's still poison. Depends on how you want to take your poison. But now, each of these performers has a certain philosophy of music. We have a philosophy of music in our team. It's no matter whether we're doing the puppets, the magic, the ventriloquism, whether we're doing the music from here, the instrumental music, it all has to glorify God or we won't do it. It all has to point toward the message from God's Word. It has to point toward the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, some of these performers, what are their philosophies? What are their philosophies of music? Well, take for instance, even out in the world, we won't even talk about the Christian realm. Just take for instance other people who are pushing religion in their music. Take for instance the Osmonds. Now, the Osmonds are avowed Mormons. They'll tell anyone that wants to ask them exactly where they stand for their religion. Everyone knows that they're Mormons. And they said that they're going to use their music to push Mormonism in some way. Either they'll sell their records and give the proceeds to the Mormons, or else they'll use it in some way to promote Mormonism. Now, one of the last times that I saw a lot of television, I saw that there was a commercial on TV that the Osmonds were using. Anybody know what that was? Yes, Hawaiian Punch. Hawaiian Punch. Now, a lot of people say, now, wait a second, Brother Chris. you talk about Hawaiian Punch. I want to see how you're going to tie that in with Mormonism. Well, if you look elsewhere on the billboards and in radio announcements, you'll find that they're always talking about, oh, drink Pepsi and Coke and Mountain Dew and coffee and all these alcoholic beverages. And what won't a Mormon drink? Any of those things? And so you see, the Hawaiian Punch, without any caffeine or anything like that, any alcohol in it, is a viable alternative for Mormons. You see, they're standing up for what they said. Or take, for instance, somebody is, oh, well, like John Denver. And now a lot of people can't see anything wrong with John Denver because they say, oh, he just writes these songs about being up on the mountainside and having the sunshine on his shoulders and he's happy and he's just out tending his garden and he's, you know, getting high in the Rocky Mountains. And yet they don't realize that John Denver has said that he will put his philosophy in all his music. He wants to actually preach through his music, his philosophy. Now, what is his philosophy? Well, he believes that one day he will become a god. That's right. He says he believes that one of these days he will become a god. Now, this is a poem that's taken from John Denver's Seasons of the Heart. I have the album right here. And I'd just like to read this poem to you, see what you think about it. It says, quote, I passed one who had slain thousands, and thousands more thronged at his side and granted him a life of peace with pennants waving gaily over his lands. And I passed one who had saved thousands. And one more came and sat by his side and played to him on an ancient lyre and kissed his hand on leave-taking. And the slayer and the savior were one man. And the thousands slain and the thousands saved were one man. And the throngs who attended the first and the one who sang for the last were one man. And we are him. Good philosophy. Pantheism, humanism. Speaking about man as being the supreme being, and we're just as good as the Savior was, and we're just as bad as the worst sinner on the earth. That's a real good philosophy. And yet, if you look through all of his songs, even on this album, you'll find that that's exactly the philosophy he's purporting, at least in one way or another, in every one of those songs. Now, you say, well, what does this mean in the Christian realm? Well, the people in the Christian realm do the same thing. They have a philosophy. Take, for instance, Andre Crouch. Now, what's his philosophy? I mean, he wrote songs like Through It All, and he wrote songs like My Tribute to God Be the Glory. I hear that quite a bit here and then in Christian circles. And what's his philosophy of music? Well, it's well known that he's just been recently busted on drug charges, been arrested for having drugs, been on the Johnny Carson show quite a few times. What's his philosophy of music? Well, it's just to make money, whatever's popular. In fact, even in a comic book about him that they put out, he even puts down the fundamentalist, makes fun of them. Real good thing for a Christian fundamentalist to follow, isn't it? Or take, for instance, this song. How many of you saw a film called A Thief in the Night some time ago? Okay, this was a theme song from that film. This isn't being sung the same way it was on the film. This is being sung by the man, yes, it is a man, who wrote the song.
Life was filled with guns and war, and everyone got trampled on the floor. I wish we'd all been ready.
The name of the song is I Wish We'd All Been Ready. The name of the man singing the song was Larry Norman. Here's a picture of him. You can see that he has hair, halfway down his shoulders. I've seen him recently since then. It's almost down to his waist. Long blonde hair. The name of the album is called Only Visiting This Planet. I guess the rest of us are glad. No, I'm just kidding. But anyway, we look on the back of the album, and we find that here's Larry, and he's very English. If you listen to him talk, you find that he's very British. And he's standing over in England in front of a bunch of great big stones piled on top of each other. And who knows what that is? Stonehenge. That's exactly what it is. It was a place of Druid worship. Well, that's a good thing to put on your Christian album, isn't it? Well, anyway, I want to show you that Larry Norman is making a mockery of Christianity. What's his philosophy of music? Well, he tells you right here. Hold on.
I want the people to know that he saved my soul, but I still like to listen to the radio. They say rock and roll is wrong, we'll give you one more chance. I say I feel so good, I gotta get up and dance. I know what's right, I know what's wrong. I don't confuse it.
He says it right here.
All I'm really trying to say is why should the devil have all the good music?
Why should the devil have all the good music? Of course, that's his philosophy of music. He thinks that that's good music, of course. But just, I won't make you listen to the rest of that. We'll go ahead and I'll just read this one last thing he has in the song. Jesus told the truth. Jesus showed the way. There's one more thing I'd like to say. They nailed him to the cross. They laid him in the ground. But they should have known you can't keep a good man down. Really good philosophy. And yet I'm sorry to say that in most of these 100 sacred favorites that you can pick up at any contemporary Christian bookstore, you'll be able to find either one, two, or even more of his songs in there. Good philosophy of music. And yet a lot of people say, well, Brother Chris, you know, I heard drums in that. And if it has drums, then I won't listen to it. If it doesn't have drums, then it must be okay. No, remember, there are a lot of other things that could make it sensual. Even the way that they sing, even the other things. Take, for instance, even what you buy at a store, if you go to a contemporary Christian bookstore, and most of them have the contemporary Christian music in them, you'll have a hard time finding anything good. If you go to a store, you might be able to find, something like this. I'm going to go over to the piano now and show you exactly what I mean. If you take, for instance, were to go to a Christian bookstore and buy this tune, okay, say it had some good words to it, and you bought this tune. Don't grade me on my piano playing. I'm a trumpet major. Anyway, take, for instance, that tune, and that's one of mine, so don't try to figure out where it came from. But if you were to buy it in most of these Christian bookstores, you'd find that what they do to the tune, even if you came home and played it just on a simple piano, you could still find the beat right there. They do something like this with it.
Thank you.
what's happened?
Well, they put the beat right in there. And even if you sing the words and you try to as hard as you can to get that out of there, you're going to find it written right in the music. But a lot of people say, well, okay, I heard the beat in that, but okay, take that out altogether. Don't have any instruments at all. Can I have still sensual music just with the words themselves? Well, listen to these four men singing.
Lord, I prayed and I prayed, hallelujah. Lord, I prayed all night long. Lord, I prayed and I prayed, hey, until I found the Lord my soul. I just could be, I just can't be content. My Lord said, I just can't be content.
You say, yes, there it is. You say, well, you know, you're trying to really pick now, and that was an old, old rock beat. That was an old 50s or somewhere around there, 50s or 60s rock beat, and that was an old beat, but you see, they can do it right like that. What I'm just trying to show you is that Satan is going to be subtle. He's not always going to come out and throw just something flat in your face. He could always just kind of sneak it in on the sidelines to try to get you to fall into that kind of a sin, to try to feed the old nature. Now, putting this into practice, what happens when you get home? Take, for instance, when you're sitting there watching television and you watch some good Christian program like The Dukes of Hazzard. What's the matter? You don't think that, well, of course it's a good Christian program. I mean, you know, they run around and they, you know, as they're racking up their cars and, you know, jumping through the air and getting away from the police, you know, thumbing their nose at authority. That's really good. And, they sing Amazing Grace once in a while, you know, while they're in their cars. And they say grace, you know, before they drink their eat their meal, you know, and, well, I hope you don't believe me that I say it's a good Christian program. I mean, the way that the idols they put up in front of our young people and the thumb in their nose at authority and making all the authority look bad. But anyway, say you're watching the middle of that program, and because you like to watch those kind of things and you kind of turn your eyes off against the things that are wrong, and all of a sudden, their sister comes out and she's not wearing very much. Oh, do you get up right away and say, oh, they shouldn't do that, and turn it off or turn it to another channel? Chances are, if you've watched 40 minutes of the program already, you'll probably watch the rest. Why? Because you don't want to miss the rest of the show, and Satan's already done to you what he wanted to do. He's already gotten that into you. What happens when the same thing when you hear beer jingles or something on TV? I knew one pastor who his kids never heard past the first line of any beer jingle that was on the radio. Why? Because it was always turned off. And I still remember in my household when we used to stand up and turn off the TV set when somebody swore or something like that happened or when something on there was wrong. Do you do that? What about in your music? Does it get halfway through a song that you're listening to and all of a sudden some worldly elements come up? Do you turn it off? Now, chances are, after you've heard the first part, you'll listen to the rest of it. And Satan's already gotten into you the things that he wanted to. Take, for instance, this song here. Now, this song is being sung by the man who wrote the song. There's a couple of things I want you to see about this song here. First of all, I want you to try to listen to the words. Now, many of you might know the words, but I want you to listen again to the words. Find out exactly what the man is saying while he's singing the song.
Go ahead, drive the nails in my hands, laugh at me where you stand. Go ahead.
The song is Rise Again. The man singing the song is also the man who wrote the song, Dallas Holm. Now, a lot of people listen to this music, and a lot of people know this song, and they say, well, what's wrong with it? Well, I read the book, the song book that came out of Dallas Holm, and he was writing his own comments before each song, and he said himself, he was sitting down when he wanted to write this song about Rise Again. He was sitting down trying to think of what the Lord Jesus Christ would have said as he was on his way to the cross. If he would have sung a song, what would he have said during that time? Now, think with me of the words. What does he have the Lord Jesus Christ saying? He's saying, go ahead. Go on, drive the nails in my hands. Go on, laugh at me where you stand. Go on, say it is me. Say I'm not the Son of God. Because one of these days I'm going to show you all. I'm going to rise again. And it's just like he has the Lord Jesus Christ going, can't hurt me. And that's exactly what he has saying in the song. He has Jesus Christ going to the cross to prove a point. He's going to
rise again just so he can show everybody. But that's not the reason he went at all, is it? No, my Bible says that Jesus Christ went to the cross out of love for each one of us, to die on the cross for our sins. He didn't go to prove any points. And yet, you see, the man of the song is not the man of the Bible. It's a different Christ. But what else I wanted to show you about this song is, listen to the middle of the song. The piano part is beautiful. My mother heard it and she said, "Boy, that's really nice." She said, "I wish more people could play like that." But what they've done is, after they've gotten you past the first verse and second verse, see if you can find any of the other elements. And this is what I mean by the strong third beat, the heavy syncopation.
Go ahead.
Guitar, the bass guitar, you hear some of the other things in the background. Now what has he done? He's gone through two verses, or a verse and an interlude, and gotten you to the next verse, and then he throws the other things at you. And you'll find that Satan will pull you along many times. I've heard many different instances of this, and they'll put you through a couple of verses, then they'll put in the sensual elements a little bit later. Take, for instance, this little kid song.
When I was a little boy, I remember
well. Now you don't
know
there's much
well
wrong at all with this song.
The
at least not rhythmically,
word for
those characteristics.
Talk,
you don't hear very much at all. But as you play through the first part of that verse, and play through the whole first verse, you don't notice anything at all. But then it comes to the second verse, and you'll notice that he adds just a little piece of the rhythm instrument, and it's a little cymbal. Watch what beat he puts it on. That's the most important.
Now to this day, you know I can't say all my plans have come to be. I've fallen short in many ways of dreams I had for me. But now I know who
see,
holds
you're really nitpicking there, Brother Chris. I mean, that's nothing really to say anything about. Yet I just want to show you exactly what he's doing. Because after he's gotten you through two verses, then he comes to the third and does this.
Now I don't have to wish on a star anymore to forecast my hopes to the wind.
Now you saw a lot more of the rhythm instruments there at the third verse. What has he waited to do? He's waited to put his sensual elements in toward the third verse. Now, if you go back and listen to the first verse again, you'll not be able to listen to that first verse without putting the strong third beat in there. Why? Because that's exactly what he meant to do all along. He just little by little started adding those things in. Now, a lot of people say, "Well, Brother Chris, I just don't see what you're talking about. That's just picking a little bit too much. Aren't you just trying to pick too much?" Yet you don't realize that Satan is going to try, even if he can only poison you a little bit at a time, he'll do it. He'll try to get you to ruin your Christian life by listening to this music. And if he can only get you a little bit of at a time, if he can't get you to listen to the hard stuff, he'll let you listen to the soft stuff and let you get just a little bit by a little bit. But you know, do these people really know what they're doing? Do these people really, understand that they're putting these sensual elements in their music? Well, some do, obviously, and some obviously don't know they're doing it. And yet many are following along with other people who do know what they're doing. Take, for instance, Amy Grant. Now, automatically, when you start saying something about Amy Grant, people say, "Oh, wait a second. Now, it's okay talking about those other people, but don't you start talking about Amy Grant." Why? Because Amy Grant is the young starlet of the contemporary Christian crowd. And they're really praising her now. She's just come up the last couple of years. But even in her very first album, Father's Eyes, in her song, My Father's Eyes, I was looking at the song and looking at the rest of the album. And down at the end of that album, there was a song called Lay Down. I said, now, why in the world use that kind of a term? That's a worldly, filthy term. But as I looked on the inside and listened to the song, it was, "Lay down your troubles or your burdens." But why didn't they say that on the outside? Well, you see, many times in these contemporary Christian jackets, you'll find that they use the song titles and the things that would make it sound like it's a secular song. Now, I'm not saying that's exactly what she was doing here in this case, but you'll find it in many other ones. In fact, there was one album I have of a song called You Make Me Feel Like a Woman. Now, does that sound like a Christian song? Well, many of these songs you could take right off a Christian station and put it in a secular station and you'd never know the difference.
Because they never say that the Lord is the one they're talking about. They never say that it's God that they're talking about. They just say, oh, I love him, or he does this, or you make me feel like a woman. All those things are just saying. In fact, even Amy Grant will sing love songs with her boyfriend. They sing, both of them, just face-to-face, almost cheek-to-cheek singing, you know, into the microphones, and they say, oh, but they're singing about the Lord. Well, you'd never know the difference. You'd never know that. Take, for instance, Bill Gaither. When he was asked about the song, The King is Coming, his secretary wrote back, I have a copy of the letter, and said, oh, well, Bill and Gloria believe that more than any other song, they believe that The King is Coming has been given to them by the Holy Spirit, and they don't believe in tampering with what the Spirit gave them. You see, this song, The King is Coming, has references to both the second coming and the rapture, both times when Jesus Christ will come to earth, and it was all mixed up. You know, they say they don't want to mess around with what the Spirit has given them. Let me ask you a question, Christian. Will there ever be a time that the Holy Spirit will say something against the Word of God? Never. Never. So if it's not the Holy Spirit giving him his music, you see, it's another spirit. And then take, for instance, this performer.
Are you tired of chasing pretty rainbows?
I saw a lot of you sit up and take notice on that one.
Are you tired of...
That's Give Them All to Jesus, sung by Evie. A lot of people look at Evie and say, oh, well, there's nothing wrong with Evie. I mean, her music is so nice and so simple. And oh, and they always picture her on the album covers as being so gentle, and the kids around her and the flowers. And it's so soft and so nice. And yet, what Evie is doing is what a lot of those soft rock groups were doing back when hard rock was so popular. They said, well, it's not so bad, and yet the elements are still there. That was one side of the album. This is just another side, another song. Notice any of the elements in there? Listen to the way she sings.
Only takes a spark to get a fire going.
Slipping and sliding. You'll find that she's trying to sound exactly like a popular singer. And not only that, you'll find the background is the same. You'll find a lot of the sensual elements in there. You see, God's Word says, in the principles, again, let's go back. What does it say? Prove all things. Hold fast to that which is good. Abstain from all appearance of evil. Then also separate, be different. There's nothing different about her vocal style or even her background than different than the world's music. And then don't be deceived. And a lot of people are being deceived by her music because the words are so nice. They like the words of the songs. And yet the music is saying something entirely different. Oh, it's not as bad, and I'll agree with you. It's not as bad as the things you might find from Larry Norman or some of those other ones. And yet the elements are still there, and you're still feeding yourself. It depends on how you want to poison yourself, all at once or by little teaspoons full. You see, it's still coming the same way. As I was looking at an album of Evie's, I looked on the back and saw a song that was called For Baby, or For Bobby. And I thought, I said, yes, well, who's this guy that wrote the song? John Duchendorf Jr. I said, what? John Duchendorf Jr.? I said, I never heard of a guy named John Duchendorf Jr. Who's this guy named Duchendorf? I thought Babcock was a bad enough name. Duchendorf, who's that? And a friend of mine who was sitting there with me said, wait a second, hold it, Chris. He said, you don't know who John Duchendorf is, do you? I said, I don't know who John Duchendorf is. Never heard of a guy named Duchendorf. He said, well, his name used to be Duchendorf before he moved to Colorado. Now his name is John Denver. Now let me ask you a question. John Denver was popular when this album was put out. Why didn't they just put John Denver's name on the back of the album? Don't you think a lot more people would have known his name? I'm sorry to say these people do know what they're doing. And we're afraid that if somebody knew that it was John Denver, he doesn't go by Duchendorf anymore. His name's John Denver. And if people would have known John Denver wrote the song, perhaps those discerning Christians wouldn't have bought it because they know what Denver stands for. See, these people are willfully deceiving people. It says in 1 Corinthians chapter 14 and verse 15, what is it then? I will pray with the Spirit, I will pray with the understanding also. I will sing with the Spirit, I will sing with the understanding also. You see, God's Word tells us that we don't just do it because it feels good. And a lot of people listen to Evie's music and Amy Grant's and some of the other ones. They say, oh, it just makes me feel so good. And yet they don't do it with the understanding. God's Word says that we need to do it with the Spirit and according to God's Word, with the understanding of God's Word. God's Word says you can't mix the two things and make them acceptable in God's sight. It's a violation of God's law.
But this last illustration I'd like to show you today probably shows you better than anything else I could show you exactly what I mean by all three of those principles. Proving those things which are wrong. Secondly, making a difference between the music of the world and the music of Christians. And thirdly, being deceived, particularly being deceived with vain words. When I first heard this performer, I said, oh, what do you know? Olivia Newton-John must have been saved. Because a few years ago, this has sounded exactly like her. Now listen to the words.
If any man be in Christ, he is a new creation.
How about the background?
If any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things pass away. Darkness to
see a few
today.
Of those elements in there? Now she changes her vocal style a little bit for this next part and sounds a little bit more like Karen Carpenter. Even the background, you'll notice, is Carpenter. Listen to it.
The things I used to think about, the things that I used to say, the places that I used to go, old things are passed away.
Now what was she trying to tell you with this song? She's saying, oh, those old things of the world are passed away. Those old things that I used to do, I don't do those anymore. The places I used to go, I don't go to those places anymore because, you see, I'm in Christ. I'm a new creature. I don't have to do those things anymore. Everything's new in Christ. Well, it's a true thought. But the music she's using is what Olivia Newton-John gave up quite a few years ago to change her style. Now she's the totally hot Olivia Newton-John. She's changed her vocal style. And even Karen Carpenter isn't around anymore. That style is gone, and yet they pick up the old styles of the world that were used for worldly things and try to reach people with a spiritual message. What does God call that? The profane things of this world, using them to try to bring people to Christ, God says it's a violation of His law, a violation of God's law. And indeed, it does say in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 17, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away, behold, all things become new. And for a Christian, the old things of this world should have passed away. The things that the world used to have or the things that the world has currently are not for a Christian. They're to be done away with. The Christian is a new creature. And he has the new song in his mouth, a new song in his life. And he doesn't need the old things of the world. Incidentally, the person singing that song was Christine Wortson. That's right. And Christine Wortson has been going that way for many, many years. And yet a lot of people have closed their minds to it because they don't want to prove all things. How about you, Christian? Will you prove all things to see whether they're good or not? I know a lot of people say, well, Brother Chris, this just hurts too much. I can't get rid of this music. This is my favorite music. I gave up that rock music a long time ago. And like one woman said, Brother Chris, you just got rid of my whole record collection. What am I going to do? Well, you replace it with good music. Again, as I said, that which says, if... prove all things, hold fast to that which is good is what the Bible says. Hold fast to that which is good, and then abstain from all appearance of evil. Get rid of the old things, but be sure to replace it with good music. Music that honors and glorifies God. Music that does not have those worldly elements in it. Music that feeds the new nature is spiritual music, first of all, and does not feed the old nature, the old sensual nature. And yet a lot of these companies and a lot of these people who push this kind of music, contemporary Christian music, say, oh, Brother Chris, I can win many more people to the Lord Jesus Christ by using this music. Well, you can say that, but you're saying it entirely against God's word. You say, why? Because you see, God has a different way of winning people to Christ. If you look with me, it is Psalm 40 and verse 3. Psalm 40 and verse 3 says something about what a Christian has when he gets saved. He has the new life, he's a new creature. And when he accepts Jesus Christ as his own personal Savior, he also has the new song. It says here in Psalm 40 and verse 3, and he hath put a new song in my mouth, even praise unto our God. Now this isn't talking about an old song, the old worldly song, the old song of the old flesh. No, that's not what it's talking about. It's talking about a new song of the new nature. What does it say? Many shall see it and fear. It what? What's it talking about? Well, the new song. Many shall see it and fear and shall trust in the Lord. You see, a lot of people are trying to win people to the Lord Jesus Christ by using the old music of the world.
God says that's not the way you do it. You do it by having the new song. You see, unsaved people don't want a phony religion. They want something that's real. They want something that's new. They don't want the old way that they've been living in the past. And even the people of the world know that the music of the world says the wrong thing. It's entirely against God. And yet, a lot of people are trying to use this old music of the world to win people for Christ. God says it won't work. It's a violation of His law. Instead, He says, many shall see the new song and fear and trust in the Lord. How about it, Christian? What kind of song do you have in your mouth? Even praise unto our God? Will people see your new song and fear and trust in the Lord? Where they hear you singing the old song of the world, having the old song of the old nature, feeding the old nature? Or will it be the new song of the redeemed? In fact, the new song that we'll sing in heaven one day. If you're here today without the Lord Jesus Christ, you don't have a new song to sing. You can't sing the song of the redeemed. All you have is the dirge of the damned to be able to sing. Because God's Word says that if you have not accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, that you are already under condemnation. John chapter 3, verse 18 says, he that believeth not is condemned already. Won't you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and accept Him as your Savior today? But if you're here today without the Lord, with the Lord Jesus Christ, and you have accepted Him as your personal Savior, won't you today realize that the old song of the world, those old elements, those things that we've seen in all that list, those characteristics of worldly music, even seeing where they've gotten those things from music history, but most importantly, to see what God's Word says, first of all, prove all things. Even if He is your favorite performer, even if it's your favorite kind of music, prove all things. Secondly, be different. Don't have the same old music of the world. Don't pick up where the world left off. Have new music, a new song. And the third thing is, don't be deceived. I'm afraid even there might be some here today that are being deceived by that old worldly music. Don't be deceived. Don't be deceived. He hath put a new song in my mouth. Even praise unto our God. Many shall see it, the new song, and fear and trust in the Lord. Christian, it's up to you. The new song or the old song? Will your song be God approved or will it be rejected by God? The choice is yours.